All right, good morning.
Good morning.
So I think we're going to start the morning off. I think we have a few people coming up, and we were going to pray over our Christmas boxes this morning.
Is this on? Yes. It is. It is. Good morning. Phil, you want to come up? Roger? Who else we got here? Dave, is Dave here? I don't think Dave is here. And yeah.
Bella and Lori. You see it. The missions people too. Bella, Lori, who else is on that? Don?
Don Harder. Yep. Beth Burley. She's on that.
I don't know if any of you have ever watched videos of the kids getting these things, but it's a pretty exciting time in those villages when these things show up. So, and they will have the Word of God presented to them with it. It doesn't come just as a toy. It comes with God's holy Word with it. So we'll pray. Ron, you want to start off?
Let's pray. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, we come before you this day and bless these Christmas gifts as they are prepared with love and they're sent with love, and the receiver will be blessed. We ask, Lord, that through this whole process that you would bless each one that had a part in it. And we just thank you for the opportunity to give back to those that in this time of giving. Thank you, Lord.
Lord God, we think of the ministry that Samaritan's Purse has in reaching people all around the world, people who are struggling in so many different ways. We pray that you would go before these boxes and that your Spirit would come into these villages and work in the lives of these people, that each one would be presented with your Word and that they would make the decision to love and follow you. That is the ultimate goal of all of this, and that's the ultimate goal of Jesus Christ when he came and gave himself for us. He is our ultimate gift, and we thank you for that. We thank you for the opportunity to share with others, and pray that you'll be with each one of these boxes as they go into these communities. In your name, amen.
Amen.
All right, if you would please stand and join us. This will be the second time that we've done Battle Belong, so hopefully we get a little bit better and it becomes a little bit more familiar to us here.
When all I see is a battle, you see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. I'll sing through the night, oh God, the battle belongs to you. When And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. When all I see is a cross, you see the empty tomb. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Shine in the shadows, win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. When I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
Amen. All right, we're going to go ahead and take a few minutes here to greet one another, say good morning, and pass the peace. So we'll go ahead and let you go ahead and do that.
Good morning. Good morning. It'll all be good. God's in control.
Were we off a little?
What?
Were we off on that one a little?
Were we off? Yeah, we could have been. Did I have us
I
too fast?
It was, no, I thought. It
was. No.
Okay.
No, it's good. Well, I think she was saying that I made it through.
Oh.
That's me.
Oh. Well, that's that's a good.
That's always a praise.
We don't have a lot of kids this morning.
There's not a lot, but there'll be a few coming up.
Yeah.
Am I doing announcements?
Yeah.
Okay. So I just have a couple of announcements. This Wednesday night is our next lift night. This will be the third time that we do this. It's geared for all ages, but especially designed for the youth. So we invite you to that. Community supper at 5:30, and then worship from 6 to 7. Super exciting. We got a lot of fun stuff going on, and we hope that you come out and join us. Tonight, we have senior high youth group, and we're going shopping for a family, and so I want to make sure that the senior high is at the church at 6 o'clock so we can leave to head over to Spencer for that. So $20 to $25 we need you to bring to put in the pot for that. So see you tonight.
Any other announcements for the greater good? All right. So the next song we're doing is My Lighthouse. This is one our youth are very familiar with. So we wanted to invite any youth that are in here to come up and join us for this one if you would like.
My Lighthouse. I know there's somebody in the back. Come on up. You can't hide. I can see you. Good job. David, Wotton. If you don't feel like you have enough room up here, don't be afraid to be down there. Like, just don't run out. Oh, yeah. Come on up, Mrs.
Suddenly, this praise team just got a lot better.
In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. Questions your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore. I won't fear what tomorrow. You are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore.
Thanks for joining us.
Thank you, you guys. That was awesome. All right, we're going to get a little bit more prayerful here.
Try.
Which means I have to, like, force myself to slow down in my head. So this morning, Pastor is going to be preaching on seeing the unseen. So I love seeing the titles because then you get to kind of anticipate what that's going to be about. And I was kind of focusing on the second Peter reading that he's going to be doing today. And there's that part in there where he talks about that God has given us the tools to be godly. And there's all those tools in there that he doesn't say that you know, you have to be perfect on these and you have to have them, but that we attempt to utilize and that we're always trying to improve on those things. And that was just something that I really meditated on as I was thinking towards the service. So hope you're able to kind of meditate on some of those today as well. So this next song we've done previously, but I think we've only done it once, so we're hitting you with a couple ones. But you guys did the first one really awesome, so I know you guys will do this one well too. In the Secret. In the secret, in the quiet place, in the stillness you are there. In the secret, in the quiet hour, I wait only for you, 'cause I want to know you more. I want to know you, I want to hear you. I want to know you more. I want to touch you. I want to see your face. I want to know you more. I'm reaching for the highest goal, that I might receive the prize. Pressing onward, crushing every hindrance aside, out of my way, 'cause I want to know you more. I want to know you, I want to hear your voice, I want to know you more. I want to touch you, I want to see your face, I want to know you more. Let's do that again.
I want to know you, I want to hear your voice, I want to know you more. I want to touch you, I want to see your face, I want to know you. In the secret, in the quiet place, in the stillness you are there.
So you guys will notice that Denny is not up here with us this morning. He is in the hospital, so we want to include him in on our prayers this morning. So please bow with me. Dear Lord God, we come to you this morning with so many blessings in our hearts that we're so grateful for, and we know that you are in charge of all of those. And so we just want to start by thanking you for those blessings. And Lord, we know that sometimes we get focused on those things that are just so difficult that weigh on our hearts and our minds and our souls. And one of those things is when a family member gets ill, is struggling, stress, mental illness, all those things. And Lord, we come to you asking for help with those things. We ask this morning specifically that you're with Denny and Kathy and their family, that you heal Denny, fill him with your love and all the blessings in the world, to bring him back to full health and to bring him back here to all of us with whom he's such a blessing for all of us. We thank you, Lord, for all of these things. We pray that as we go through this service, that you would guide pastors' words, that they would be scriptural and would be your words, Lord, and that your Holy Spirit would enter all of us throughout this service. Thank you, Lord, for all that you've done, all that you do, and all that you will do. We pray this as we pray the prayer that you taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Children, gotta stay standing.
Children can go. You gotta stay standing. It's gymnastics, Maureen. You gotta stand back up. All right. Before Corey escapes. So here's what I want you to do, and I'm gonna illustrate it to you with Corey. So I want you to grab the arm, not his hand. This is Roman soldier handshake. So you grab here. So go to the person next to you, grab them like the Roman soldier, and say, I can see. Thank you. Well, not all in unison. Do it as spontaneous. Find that person next to you, grab their arm and say, I can see. I can see. All right, you can be seated. We are such creatures of habit. Hey, it's good to be here this morning. I am advertising for next week's message. I don't want you to miss next week. Make sure you invite, make sure you tell, because next week is a very important message, Why Salt. We're going to be talking about a salt covenant relationship that extends from the relationship with the blood of Jesus and into the covenant relationship. So don't miss next week, Why Salt. Today, I can see. We're going to look at seeing the unseen. It's an interesting topic. So what we do in fellowship. Next week, you're also hopefully going to get to see the vision statement. It's going to be on the screen. It's going to be finalized this week. One of the key words in that is fellowship. So what do we do in the fellowship? Fellowship is koinonia, which is a called out group of people who confess to believe in the common cause. Our common cause is Jesus Christ. So what do we do here? Why do you come to church? Some of you parents are bringing a confirmation kid because their son or daughter has to take notes. That's why you're here. Well, that's a good thing. Some of you are here because that's what you do on Sunday morning. Some of you are here because you want to get fed the Word, or maybe all of you are here to get fed the Word of God. So what we do on Sunday morning and what the message is intended to do is to point you to the cross of Jesus Christ. Amen? That's the goal, and if you don't bring your Bible with you to church, I would encourage you to take a note and take the scripture and then go to your Bible during the week and reread these scriptures, because then you will, oh, that's what Pastor was talking about. So everything we do points us to Jesus. Drive you to the feet of Christ. Everything we do is biblical. Driving you to the feet of the cross of Jesus Christ. And with that, then we believe that the Word is the true Word of God. And everybody said? Amen. So we go to the Word, we go to the cross, you go to where it all starts, and then you can say, this is a good day. Right? So I've taught you, when you get out of bed in the morning and your feet hit the floor, I have been redeemed. I am the righteousness of Christ. You can even go to 2 Corinthians 5:21, where that came from. He who knew no sin became, your feet just hit the floor. He who knew no sin became sin, so that I could become the righteousness of Christ. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. This is going to be a good day. I want you to add that to that. How many of you can say right now, this is going to be a good day? Right? Say it like you mean it. This is going to be a good day. Yeah, you're born again believers. That's a good day. I did a sermon series years ago, Best Day of Your Life. And some parts of this today are coming out of this brother's testimony, because about two sermons into it, he came to me and he said, you got to stop saying that. Best day of your life. He said, how can it be the best day of my life? I said, you're a born again believer. It's the best day of your life. Well, he had a lot of struggles. And
We got through it, and he's realizing now that every day can be the best day of your life. So you woke up this morning, you came to church, you came to a worship that's going to point you to the feet, to the foot of the cross, and we can wake up and say, this is a good day. We're going to get there. Today, seeing the unseen, 2 Peter 1, 1 through 11. We're going to wake up. We're going to wake up. Now, we're going to go through this today systematically. And I want you to think about the fact that the next time you pray, it's going to be the most intimate prayer you ever prayed. Have you ever thought about that? Or do you just go to God and say, well, here's another prayer? No, what if you went to God and say, this prayer is going to be the most intimate prayer I ever pray? I come to church and I say, God, this church service is going to be the most intimate church service we've ever had. Why don't we think in those terms? Why don't we realize the power that we actually have? And every time we come to the Word, we come to worship, we come to the cross, it will be like none other. Something's stopping you. And Peter bridges this. This is what he says, Simon Peter, a servant of the apostle of Jesus Christ. To those who have obtained a faith, be careful, of equal standing with ours. Sometimes when you read scripture, you just got to slow down. Okay? So some of you in church say, well, you know, the elders or the deacons, woo, or the pastor, I was called once, and she gave me a prayer request, and she says, I want you to pray this prayer because you got the red telephone. I was like, come on. So I don't even know what that means. But to those who have obtained a faith of equal standing. Now, I want you to hear that today, because the elders, the deacons, the leadership for Sunday school, the pastor, no. Paul says, listen, you haven't obtained a faith that's equal to all of us, of equal standing. Why? Because it came from the righteousness of our God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Get it out of your head that you're inferior. Get it out of your head today that, well, I'm not like, no. You've obtained a faith of equal standing. You're on the same ground as the other believers. Came from the righteousness of my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Verse 2, may grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus Christ our Lord. So Peter starts out, he puts us all on the same level. He says, there's none of this. He says, you believe in Jesus, we're all on the same page. His divine power has granted to us 13% of the things that pertain to life. I love, you know, I've taught you that some of the most powerful words in Scripture have two, three, or four letters. And here's a three-letter word that I want you to hear loud and clear. The grace and peace is multiplied. His divine power has granted to us all things. Now just slow down for a minute. Think about this. You end up by Wednesday noon, and you got a problem. And you begin to think that the problem's bigger than your God. And you begin to forget about the church service. So the pastor said that everything we do here points you to the foot of the cross. But Peter's making it clear. He hammers away at this. He says that the divine power. What is that? What is that? English teachers that are here, you know, that I English was not my strong suit. I'm not a writer, and I don't like English, and I make a lot of grammatical errors. And my Old Testament homiletics preacher, he said, you know, you make an error, it's like you got a big pimple right on your face. And he was strict on grammatics. But what is this divine power? What is that? And he says, this divine power has granted you all things that pertain to your life. Think of those words. He says, this power has granted you anything and everything you need to get through life. So you go to the doctor, hey, no worries. I got the divine power that's going to take care of me. Marriage is in trouble. I got the divine power. So many times we go to God and we beg and we plead for authority. We beg and plead for power. We beg and plead for healing. And I just can imagine, I mean, God is grace, but he's like, have you ever thought about who's in you? Why are you even asking me for this request? The divine power is the fact that we have the presence of the Holy Spirit in us. We have the power of the Holy Spirit in us, and he says this divine power has been given to you so that all things that pertain to life and godliness, you don't need anything. Right? You have it all. All of it has been given to you that pertains to your life. So in other words, when you stub your toe in the middle of the night and you rip off a line of cuss words, you have everything you need to say, God, I didn't need to do that. And for whatever reason, my size 15 feet get me in trouble a lot. And Ginger looks at me and says, when are you going to learn how big your feet are? Because I come hobbling around the corner. Oh, I ran into the... You have everything you need to make it through this life. That's what he's saying. You have everything already given for godliness. We're going to go slow today. Now think of this. You have everything you need for life, and you have everything you need to be godly. So why is it then sometimes when you get upset at the person and you get angry and you say words to them, maybe your wife, maybe your kids, but in reality you have everything you need to be godly through the knowledge of Jesus, him who called us to his own glory and excellence. Folks, you have everything you need to be the person God has called you to be. And I encourage you to stop going to prayer and begging God, please. No, we're not a people who are born again and go begging to a higher authority. We go to God and say, thank you, Jesus, for instilling, putting into me everything I need to put up with the wayward child, to put up with the crazy whatever, some of you get mad at your pastor. That's all right. Pastors get mad at people. We have everything we need to get through this and called us in his own glory and excellence, by which he has granted to us his precious and very great promise. What's the precious and very great promise? You've been instilled with the Holy Spirit and you have the words of eternal life. You've been saved. So that through them you may become partakers of the divine nature. Okay, just hold on for a minute. Oh my gosh, he says you got the Holy Spirit, you got everything you need in life, you got everything you need to be godly, and you have become partakers of his divine nature. That's a zinger. Guys, the next time you look at your wife and you say, I don't know who she is. She has done some things that make no sense. You go back to this verse, and you say, I'm a partaker of the divine nature. I can't figure it out, but Jesus can. You have it. Having escaped from the corruption that is in the world because of the sinful desires. That's how he finishes it. He says, listen, you have all you need to live this life of godliness. You're a partaker of his divine nature, and you can escape from the worldly desires. How many of you ever read 2 Peter chapter 1 before like this? You've got what it takes not to fall into the desires of the world. Sinful desires. For this very reason, make every effort to supplement your faith with virtue, virtue with knowledge, knowledge with self-control, self-control with steadfastness, steadfastness with godliness. Godliness with brotherly affection with love. For if these qualities are yours and are increasing, they keep you from being ineffective. This is so cool. What's Jesus say? That if you abide in me, you will bear fruit? It's a surefire promise that you will not be ineffective. They keep you from being ineffective or unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord and Jesus Christ. Whoever lacks these qualities, remember Peter, the man who puts his mouth in gear before his brain, but he's learning now. He's been touched by the Holy Spirit. For whoever lacks these qualities is so nearsighted that he is blind. If you're not living out the first eight verses that I just read to you, realizing that you got the Holy Spirit, you got the divine qualities for life, you got the divine qualities to be godly, you can be effective, you have all of this. And he says, if you're not living this out, you are blind. And you have forgotten that he was cleansed from his former sins. Therefore, brothers, it's a bridge, it's there, what's it there for? Then he says this, brothers, be all the more diligent to confirm your calling and election. For if you practice these qualities, you will never fall. Do you love the promises of Scripture? Practice what I just said, and you will never fall. And people go through life as a Christian, where is my God? How come I can't do this? And why isn't this working? Because you haven't put in the effort to practice the qualities so you never fall. For in this way, there will be richly provided for you an inheritance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Go back one slide. For these qualities are increasing for you, and you cannot be ineffective. Go back one more slide. Thank you. For this very reason, make every effort. God's given us all we need. God's given us everything we can do this. You can be the one who is the most alive. Don't believe the lies that you're inferior. You are wonderfully and marvelously created in the eyes of God. You have His Holy Spirit in you, and you can do it. Some of you are sitting here today, you're up against the wall, you don't know how you're going to get through it, and I encourage you to go home and read this text and read this text and read this text until the Holy Spirit enlightens you to the point. And there's the problem. How many times did I say read the text 3? For this very reason, make every effort. So many people call themselves a Christian. I went to church on Sunday morning. I put my tithe in the offering plate. And by Tuesday afternoon, the Holy Spirit forgot about me and it didn't work. You know how many people run that routine? The Holy Spirit must have forgot about me. I don't feel His presence. My hair didn't stand up in worship Sunday. Listen, He says, make every effort. You have to make an effort at this. I'm not a huge reader. And I told you, I'm not a writer. The doctorate degree was torture. But he says you got to make the effort. Do you realize that if you read the Bible 10 minutes a day, you will read the Bible through in a year? 10 minutes a day. Making the effort. The gentleman that had the problem with the Best Day of Your Life sermon series, this was his word. He said, Pastor, you got to tell people it takes effort, it takes work. And listen, we're not talking about salvation. You're not trying to earn your salvation. We're talking about saved people who are struggling. And for this reason, we have to put in the time. You're here today. You're here in the sanctuary for this very reason, because you're putting in the time to learn, to understand, to gain the knowledge, the wisdom of who God is. There's just this power that we do not tap into. We just don't do it. And you heard me say 2 weeks ago that the Old Testament people, we get to heaven and we can't wait to see David. What was it like to kill a giant with a rock? Man, Moses, what was it like to go up and see God in a burning bush? You know, what was it like to part the Red Sea? And we think all of these Old Testament prophets, what was it like to hear the voice of God? And then Isaiah, you wrote the whole book within the book. And you know what? They're going to look at us and just simply say, what was it like to have the power of the Holy Spirit? A jaw dropper. Oh, well, I guess I never thought about that. What was it like to have the Holy Spirit? The Old Testament, they're wanting for it to come. God's pointing towards a time in the future. He says, there's going to come a day where I put my Spirit in people. Look at Ezekiel. 36, 26, and 27. And I will give you a new heart and a new spirit I will put in you, within you. This is in the future. They're like, Ezekiel, God, when will this happen? Well, I'm going to do it, and I'm going to put my spirit in. I'm going to put it within you, and I will remove the old heart of stone from your flesh, and I'll give you a heart of flesh, and I'll give you a heart of flesh, and I'll put my spirit in you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. And Ezekiel hears this and he says, there's going to come a time in the future where God's going to put his spirit in people and we're going to get to see this. And folks, we're living in that time. I kind of messed up yesterday. I wanted chicken bones. I even made some calls. They're not here today. And I asked one couple, I said, what'd you have for supper? I hope you had chicken because I want the bones. And it was Randy and Jackie Kramer, and he says, we're having tacos. Sorry, no bones here. But my illustrative point is I want you to imagine if I had the chicken bones here, because in Ezekiel 37, Ginger and I, our personal ministry, Four Winds Ministry, is based off of Ezekiel 37. Now, just think about this. We're talking about a time in the future where the Holy Spirit's going to be put in people, and God tells Ezekiel, he says, talk to the bones. Now imagine, I got chicken bones here, and he says, talk to those bones. And as you prophesy to the bones, he says, there's going to become gizzard and heart and talons, and the organs are going to form. Wouldn't that be amazing to watch? And then he says, the tendons and the snoos, it's called, the tendons and the skin's going to come on it. Could you imagine that bird sitting right here? It's just a bunch of bones. Pretty soon there's a little heart in there, and there's a little gizzard and a little liver. Some of you who have butchered chickens, you know what I'm talking about. And it forms. And then it gets skin. And he says, Ezekiel, continue to talk to the bones. And as the organs happen and the skin happens, and they came together and they came to life. And he says, then prophesy to the north, south, east, and west, and breathe the spirit into him. And you breathe the spirit into him, and he's got feathers. And he hops up, and he runs out the door. Wouldn't that be wild? That was my thought process preparing this. I thought, God, I want to see if we can do that. But here's the point. The scripture that I just shared with you in Peter, you're that person. You were dead in your trespasses and sins. And when you heard the good news and you confessed to believe, God put a new heart in you. Not one of stone, but of flesh. God put new skin on you, put new brains in you. He made you brand new, and he brought you to life, and now here you are today, standing there as a living, breathing human being that has been molded and shaped and brought together in the presence of God, and you have him in you. You ever think about that? That's the picture in Ezekiel. It was for a future time. So when people see you, they should long for nothing else but to see the power of God in you, in you, in you. When they encounter a Christian, they should see dead bones brought to life. They should see something so magnificent. And then here's what happens. They see a Christian take the Lord's name in vain. They see a Christian doing acts that the world does. What it say in 1 Peter? You've been given the divine authority to be partakers, not to succumb to the world. When they see us, they should see this person that is so unique, and we're walking in his divine nature, and we can be godly. You know what God demands? Moral excellence. 10 minutes a day, make every effort for the self-control. I'm encouraging you today to put in the effort. I'm encouraging you today to let the Spirit move. And to understand that you have in you what it takes. Some of you are dealing with an addiction right now and you want to get rid of it. Some of you have been dealing with an addiction for 40 years, 20 years, 5 years, whatever it is. It's the silent addictions that nobody gets to see. It's the pornography. It's the affairs online. These are the things that people are coming into counseling offices today. Well, she's in a different country. Nobody will ever know. If it's online, everybody's going to know. These are the addictions that you're struggling with, and yet God says, bring it to light. Know the word, make every effort. And some people, they can bring it to the Lord, bam, it's gone. Some people, it takes effort, and they got to work at it. We got a dear brother in Minnesota, bib overalls every Sunday, two-buckle overshoes. The farmers that are in here know what a two-buckle overshoe is. That was his dress. Long underwear, year-round. And you'd look at this guy, and you would think, whoa. His story was so profound. I wanted to use it today, and they've been looking for it because we videoed it and we lost it. Alcoholic for 40 years. Hired man, worked all day as a hired man, get off 8, 9 o'clock at night. He would go to the bar. He would close the bar down at 2 a.m. He would buy a case of beer. That would get him home. He would sleep from 4 to 6, and he would go back to work. That was his routine. Like, how does the body even survive that? That was his life. And one time, he had a little rambler. Rambler. Rambler's a rambler. And he went off a dead-end road. And he went through the ditch. And he said, when I looked out the window, I was level with the highline wires. And when he landed, the front wheels went like this, and the fenders were bubbled up, and he got it home, and he fell out on the lawn. It was dewy, so it wasn't quite sunrise yet, and he said, I was stoned, and I fell down face first in that grass, and he said, I cried out to Jesus, I can't do this anymore. I can't do this anymore. 25 minutes later, he woke up when the sun hit him in the face as if he had never drank. And he never drank again. Sometimes God takes it away just like that. Sometimes it happens like that. And his testimony, and then the other one was he smoked a pipe and cigarettes so profoundly. He'd smoke 3 packs of cigarettes a day farming. Then he'd get home at night and he'd smoke his pipe. And he says, I'm sitting in the living room and I'm watching TV and I can't quite see the TV because the pipe smoke was so intense in the living room. Threw the pipe aside and said, Jesus, I'm done. Take it away. Never smoked pipe or cigarette again. Sometimes God will work that way, but you have to put in the effort, is what I'm saying. You have to put in the effort to prompt the Holy Spirit to work it through you, even though it's all there. Brothers and sisters in Christ, listen to me. Peter says, you have it all. And Ezekiel could see it in the future, and we get to live that. We get to receive that. And yet we diminish the power of God. Verse 8. Guarantees that we will be productive, we'll be effective. And so many people go through their life never getting this. 5 years of college, I don't know what I'm going to do. 20 years in a career, I'm worthless. I've put the bolt in the same hole for 25 years. I don't know what I'm going to do. And yet you got the power of the Holy Spirit in you. You can tell I'm an eternal optimist. God says you have everything you need right there, partaker of the divine image. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is a big God. And he wants the best for you. Look at 2 Corinthians 4:18 as we close. Before I get to that, 2 Kings, I didn't give you this, Brenda, don't worry. But to see the unseen of what you have within you, 2 Kings chapter 6, Elijah gets woke up in the middle of the night. And the runner, the guy says, listen, with this battle we're going to go out to do in the morning, there's no way that we're going to win this thing because you go out your door, he says, we are surrounded and we're in trouble. And Elijah says, Father, open his eyes so that he can see what I see. And he prays that over the little runner servant, and the runner servant goes outside, and he sees an angelic host with fiery swords that surround the other ones who are there. And Elijah says, we're not in trouble. He was able to see the unseen. We have in us what it takes, and this is what Paul writes to the church in Corinth. As long as we look not to the things that are seen. Folks, stop looking at the world. You know how many people look to the checking account, the 401, whatever the account is. You know how many people look to that and find security? He says, look at the things, not to look at the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. This is powerful. You don't look to your pastor. You don't look to your husband, to your wife. He says, I want you to step into the spiritual realm, and to see the unseen means you can see. For the things that are seen are transient. Did you realize that everything that you can see will be gone, including you? Get used to it. Look in the mirror today when you get home, and guess what? You won't look like that tomorrow. Hallelujah. In fact, we are so fragile, get used to it. Look in the mirror, you realize, hey, I'm not going to look like that tomorrow. And in fact, I might not even be here tomorrow. For the things that are seen are transient. Get used to the fact that this is so temporary, so minor, so small. David says it's like the vapor in a teapot. It's here and then, poof, you're gone. Yet we get so wound up in the short, you know, right now we're living to be 80-some years old. And we think for this 80 years, whoo, we're talking eternity. He says, don't get caught up in that. But the things that are unseen are eternal. That's when I get excited. I mean, man. So, I'm going to leave you with an exercise today. Because Peter says we have it all, right? Peter said we have the divine power, we have the godliness for this life and the next. We're going to be able to look at this thing not from the worldly perspective. Peter says you got it all right there. So if that's the case, and we're supposed to see the unseen, you do realize that's my most favorite word in Scripture, to see with an understanding. But so then when we don't look at the world, we can see the eternal. And God says, I want to worship with you in spirit and truth. So I'm going to have you do an exercise today. I mean, if you're that born-again believer and you believe that the chicken got bones on it and he got feathers and hair and ran down the aisle, that's you. And he put the spirit in you. And he says, if that's you, then you can see the unseen because those are the things that are eternal. When's the last time you went to the Lord in prayer and closed your eyes and said, I want to see the unseen. I want to see what is real. So many of you close your eyes and you go to the Lord in prayer and the car needs to change oil this week. I got a list laying on my desk at work. I got to make this phone call. Oh, yeah, by the way, God, yeah, your love, I love you. And then you go back into the world. Oh, yeah, God, thank you for saving me. And then you go back into the world. Right? That's how we pray. But God says, I put my divine power in you. I have the Holy Spirit put in you. I want you to tap into the Spirit. And I don't want you to think about the world. So I'm going to encourage you, and we're going to do it today. That when you close your eyes and you tap into the unseen, how do you do that? Ladies, it's a lot harder for you than it is for us guys because us guys can go to the nothing box. Right? How many of you been here? I taught you that. Some of you are looking at me like, what? Guys are compartmentalized. We are boxed So you go to church, you pull out your church box. Ladies, most of you can sit in church and you think about what you're going to make for dinner. You think about the clothes you're going to wear tomorrow. You're thinking about, you got to tell your husband he needs new tires on my car. That's how your brain works. Guys, we don't. We're compartmentalized. So we pull the church box open or in the church box. But I'm going to teach you a lesson on how to pull the prayer box open to leave that world aside. Because once you learn the technique to be in the Spirit, that's when you get to see the unseen. That's when you get real life. So, ladies, you don't have a nothing box, but I can show you how to get to a nothing box. And all the women said, amen. I know a lot of gals that look at their man and say, I want your nothing box. Because your husband can be looking at the TV at night and you say, honey, what are you thinking about? Nothing. And he literally is thinking about nothing. All the women's heads are being nodded right now. That's the real deal. I had a lady come into my office and she was married 6 months, bawling her eyes out. And she goes, I called my husband at work and he's not thinking about me. I said, it's because he's got his work box open, not his honey box. I think about him all the time. He's not thinking about you all the time. We'll get to a point. I'll have a sermon on that. I've done some teaching on that. It's fun stuff. So, but in prayer, you want to get to that point where that world stuff is not there. So just follow along with me. This isn't weird. Jesus taught meditation, and he says, I want you to be in the Spirit. I want you to be able to see the unseen. I want you to step into the eternal realm so that when you and I pray, be still and know that I am God, and you can hear my voice. You can hear his voice. You can hear his voice. Maybe a still, quiet voice. Maybe a loud voice. I've been blessed with an opportunity to hear God's voice. I've heard it at a young age. I've heard it loud. I've heard it soft. I've had a couple times in life where there were some big major changes coming up, and in my prayer time, Linford! That loud. That'll straighten you up. And it's not my mom's voice either. God wants your attention. And he wants to speak to us. And Peter says we got it all. So close your eyes. Just close your eyes and look at the backside of your eyelids. Just focus on the backside of your eyelids. You might see some of the color scheme there. You might see some of the blues and the greens and just kind of floating around. And this is what God says, be still and know that I am God. And if a thought pops in there, well, I got the oven on for dinner. Just look at the backside of those eyelids and say that with me. Be still and know that I am God. And you might have to just keep saying that. Be still and know that I am God. And settle into his presence. And the minute a thought comes, just say, be still and know that I am God. And pretty soon the thoughts stop. And you're one with him. Father, we ask today that as we sit in your presence and we bask in your authority and we know that your Spirit lies within us as we're being still to know that you are God. Let the thoughts slip aside. Let your words ring true. Be still and know that I am God. You now have the power and authority to overcome anything you're dealing with. You now walk and just bask in his presence. Father, I thank you for what you're doing at Grace. Let all the people here today be still and know that you are God as they leave, and let them entertain this meditative prayer time. Your word promises us that when we function in the unseen, we have it all. Let us be still in your presence and reveal yourself to us in a new and powerful way. This world right now is hammering on us, but yet the light will overcome. Fill us with the hope and the joy of being your sons and daughters. Let us live a life basking in your presence. And when we leave here today, let the world see someone who's been born again, someone who has a new heart, a new flesh, a new mind. Let the world see us in the stillness and the power and the authority. I thank you for what you're doing in the fellowship here today. In your name we pray. Amen.
All right, please join us.
When the stars came crashing down, pieces to the ground. I was all alone down here, trapped beneath the atmosphere. Then I felt somebody hold my ear. I spun around and caught a flame, gave into a God I didn't know. And now everything is falling into place. A brand new life is calling, and I owe it all to grace. So much finer living in your world, Savior, what you did for me. Gave me something I want everyone to see. When we stumble and it all goes wrong, only you can make it right, so I say, candle on the sill, knowing you'll be always knocking at the door. Oh God, I just want to love on everyone. All I have is yours to give, so let the people come. So much brighter living in your world, saving what you did for me. You gave me something I want everyone to see. When we stumble and it all goes wrong, only you can make it right, so I say, oh, learning to be the light, oh, shadows hide, light that breaks the curse of pride, light that takes the weary in its arms. When it all came crashing down, there was only darkness all around, but in the distance I could see a flame. So much brighter living in your world, saving what you did for me. Gave me something I want everyone, and I mean everyone, to see. When we stumble and it all goes wrong, only you can make it right. say, oh, I'm learning to be the light. Oh,
please prepare for the benediction. The sunset comes upon your day and fades throughout the west. As evening comes and lulls your souls to rest. May you leave this place, go out into the world with the tools that God has given us all to be godly to all those that we run into so that they too can see our Lord, the God, in your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I have an announcement. I would like, Ken and Lori are going to bring their pickup right by the door, and that's going to call these Christmas boxes to Worthington tomorrow. But I would like our congregation to go ahead and be symbolic of a gift from our congregation. Would everybody go up? We have over 100 people here. Everybody go up and at least try and get a hold of one. Carry those out and carry them to the door for us. Would you do that for us, please? I'd like the congregation to go to the front and pick up all of those boxes and bring them to the door. Thank you.